Smith's son.
Okay.
And I'm Arnold's son and Larry's older brother, and Randy's dad.
Okay.
Yeah. I guess that's self-explanatory.
So Arnold's grandson,
if you say
and
who you
Arnold's
are,
son, and Larry's nephew. And we're all here in Brentwood.
And what's today's date?
Today is the day after Mozart's birthday.
And also your birthday.
Okay.
And Larry's birthday.
I was born on, or Mozart was born on my birthday, and my sister was born on Braun's birthday, and my father was born on Schoenberg's birthday, and Ronnie was born on
my own birthday.
Woo!
So, I have to do something
So I'm Hillary, and we're at the Schoenberg's house with Schoenberg's here. And I just had a quick question, which is, how often do you guys listen to Arnold Schoenberg's music?
That's a good question. Dad?
I can't give it in days, but quite often, because we go to concerts whenever we have a chance.
Mm-hmm.
We listen to recordings, including
mm-hmm.
yours, when we have a chance.
Uh-huh.
And that's about it. So I listen in the car a lot.
Are most of the performances in the United States or in Europe?
The live performances mm-hmm. are mostly in Europe.
And how far is the farthest you've ever gone to see a performance?
Berlin.
I'm going to Westwood tonight to get Fiddler to Nacht, which is all of 2 miles away.
Nice.
So that's not too bad.
So it's from home to overseas.
Yeah.
Yeah. And did you grow up listening to the music from birth, or were you introduced to it later?
We were introduced to it, certainly. We heard it around the home when it was played. There wasn't that much played unless we had recordings here or quartets were practicing here with my father.
Was he very involved in preparing performances?
Preparing performances?
Yeah, like working with the musicians to get something ready for concert.
With the quartets he was, but other than that he wasn't.
With Pierre Lunaire he was also when they were here. I was just talking with Nuri about that. They had a recording that they did with Eric Astidri, Wagner at Salto Viertels, and she says she remembers them preparing here with him.
Hmm.
So with Storyman and Rudy. But anyway, this is all before I was born.
I think he always would
have, I know.
I suspect he always would have liked to have been,
mm-hmm.
but wasn't allowed to be.
I see.
I can't be sure of that. I know that he always wrote very, certainly for his operas, he wrote very strict directions on how everything was to be done, and it was never followed.
Oh, that's too bad.
Yeah, it was. He felt bad about that.
Just put in all that time and then people just don't pay attention.
And that's still done, and we still feel bad about it and are impotent in trying to do something about it.
Well, so here's to trying to make things back to what they were supposed to be and trying to bring it back. So let's say bye for now. Bye,
bye
everyone.
For now.
Bye. Okay, thanks.
Okay, let's do negative.
I've got my leg exercise for the day. Squatting. Okay.
Whoops,
yeah, you have to get in.
Okay.
All right.
Okay, you tell me when.
Okay.
Go.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Randy Schoenberg. I'm the grandson of Arnold Schoenberg. And Hillary, I'd like to ask you some questions that my grandfather asked to Louis Krasner, the first violinist who ever played the Schoenberg Violin Concerto.
Okay.
So question one is everything clear in my tempo marks?
I think so. I think the tempo markings are very clear. People don't always play the tempo markings, but definitely they're clear and they're doable.
Good. Second question, how is the orchestra dynamically? Does the violin always easily dominate, or are there dark spots where it is difficult or even impossible?
It depends on the orchestra and how they're playing. It depends on the conductor and how much he's putting a priority on that particular thing. It is possible everywhere to be heard, but sometimes you have to work on it so that the orchestra relaxes enough to not play too loud. When an orchestra is scared, sometimes when they don't know a piece very well, sometimes they'll play louder and sort of stiffen up, and it actually sounds better when it's more flexible and lighter.
Okay, third question, do all the Hauptstimmen, the main voices, distinctly come to the fore?
Not automatically, but you can work it out so that they do. But you have to, as a performer, analyze it and figure out where those are. Your, Mr. Schoenberg's music is very layered, so it's important to sort through the layers before you put them back together.
And did he mark when the violin has the main voice, the Hauptstimme?
I assume, as the soloist, I always assume when I'm supposed to be playing, there's something important to be heard. But I've been humbled over the years to realize that sometimes I'm not the most important voice in the performance, so you do a lot of that by context.
Okay, sorry, that was my question. Anyway, the fourth question is, can you name sections which, according to your impressions or friends of yours, have been A, distinctly disliked by the audience or by music lovers, or B, agreeable to the same or others?
I've never had anyone analyze the music saying, I like this part and I don't like that part in a kind of a review or a post-concert discussion. But when I work with people on it, I definitely I get the sense that people like certain parts and other parts are a little bit more bewildering, but that's usually at the beginning of the process. There are certain parts of the piece that when you first play them are really rhythmic and are kind of catchy, and people are amused by the sort of friendly aspect of them, and so they enjoy playing them. And then there are other parts that we usually wind up laughing because something goes terribly wrong when we're first reading through the piece, and it just sounds horrible when it's wrong. And then you get it right, and all of a sudden things fall into place. You think, oh, okay, that's what it's supposed to sound like. And then it's more enjoyable to play. So I think in the end, when you've had enough time to rehearse the piece, when you have really prepared everything individually and you're comfortable with the parts that you're playing, then the whole thing holds together and the whole thing is really enjoyable to play, and hopefully that carries over to the audience as well, because that's the goal of every performer, is to let the audience feel the way they do when they're performing.
Great. Thanks so much. I'm sure my grandfather would have loved to have those answers.
Well, maybe someday he'll come back and do something on YouTube. Okay.